All right, yet again, it's that time to talk about gaming stuff that's going on. So, welcome back to the Gaming Ramble, episode 16. Once again, the late edition. This time, though, the reason is kind of twofold. One was doing stuff that took up more time. Again, that happened. I wasn't trying to. But the other one is I thought I came up with something that might help prevent this from happening, or not so much make this faster to do. I mean, recording, you only. It's how long it takes to do, but all the other things to it, and it just didn't work out, so, and it caused problems, and I had to, basically, I had half of it done, and it was unusable, became a mess, so I had to do it over again anyway, and I didn't have enough time, so here I am doing it now. Don't mean for that to happen, but there you go, that's my kind of explanation. Sorry. Anyway, so, quite a few things to talk about here, although this might be kind of a shorter show, given what somebody's about, and there's not that much I can talk about with them, but there are some good ones here, and yet again, VR comes up, so this is the second time in a row talking about VR here, but it's a little bit different than that, and one thing to end it with, which is pretty quick, but an important thing to put out there, I think, if you don't already know about it. It'll be good for any of you who like to import games, obviously. There are a few strings attached, but I'll get to it when I get to it. Before I start it, though, I do want to say one last thing on a certain subject, which I actually mentioned in the beginning of my kind of intro in the last episode. If you listen to it, you know exactly what I mean. And I'm pretty sure many of you are sick of hearing about it, as I've noticed in many are, so I can understand, believe me, I am too. I won't go on about it too long, though. I just want to say I am not surprised how the Coleco Chameleon thing ended. I saw this happening. In fact, I'm glad that you're not going to see me or hear me say that I'm sorry to see it go. As I said in the last episode, and I've mentioned it before in the past when it was still called the Retro VGS, the whole thing from the beginning seemed like a very poorly planned idea. It seemed scummy and shady, and no, it was just, it had to go. It was poorly planned, and the one running it was clearly kind of corrupt in a way. So, yeah, not surprised to see it pretty much get all shut down, so... that's the way it goes sometimes. But we have other stuff to look forward to that actually will work out, so that's good. Nothing else really I want to mention as far as that's not any kind of the main stories I want to talk about. Not yet, anyway. So maybe next week's episode I will. Anyway, for now though, let's get into what the actual main topics are for this episode. Alright, and the first thing here is retro-related, in a way, and some of you might find this surprising, especially given if you never really played the game much, or games on the computer in general, but Blizzard has always been pretty good with supporting and updating their older games. In the case of this one, it's 16 years old now, but I'm glad to see that they're still doing this, and they are pretty much staying to what they have done. They really do care about their older games, and understand that there are still a pretty big sizable... fan base and player base for these games, so good on them for that. I definitely appreciate it. It's just like what GOD does in making older games run on newer hardware, only in this case they're only doing it for theirs, but still. Very good that they did this, and it's a game I used to play a lot myself, had a lot of fun with it, even played it online with Battle.net, not so much anymore, and even towards the end at most anymore, once in a great while, I feel like going back into it and playing the single player. Outside of that, I just play Torchlight 2, which essentially is kind of the successor to the Diablo series. Anyway, yes, what this is about, Diablo 2 has received another patch, a kind of surprise patch, for the first time in the last 5 years. Yes, the game's been out for 16 years, and the last time I got a patch until recently was 5 years ago, which I remember that one too. But this patch is kind of a little bit more significant than the last one it got, which I'll explain why. Anyway, as I said, Blizzard has been good on this for a long time, supporting their older games, which is a good thing, no question about it. And they have released patch 1.14 for Diablo 2 very recently, which is up from 1.13D, which improved the Battle.net integration and fixed some bugs. This new one does that too, but it also does something much more important, and that is it basically does things to the game to make it work better with modern operating systems. That is a very important thing, because I can tell you personally, Diablo 2, I'm trying to think exactly, it was Windows 7, I remember, was when I started noticing some fairly annoying and fairly consistent problems. Windows 7 is a much more newer operating system than what it was designed to run on. And even on XP, there was a few flaws with it, but then as it kept going on, Windows 7, like I said, and then there was Windows 8.1, I noticed even more issues, some of the same ones, some different ones. And Windows 10, I actually haven't even bothered with it yet because I haven't had Windows 10 all that long, and I just, because I knew the problems with that one, I wasn't really looking forward to it. But now I'm actually thinking about going back into it, I gotta say, because they've done this. So yes, this latest patch 1.14 has made it so that it works better on modern operating systems. Very important, because there's still a lot of people who play Diablo 2. One of the main reasons for that is the mods, as well as the expansion Diablo 2 Lord of Destruction, which I also have. In fact, more people actually prefer that these days, but whatever. And they also have, like I said, done things just like the last patch where they improved BattleNet integration and fixed bugs and all that kind of stuff. Despite how old it is, they still kind of find this kind of thing and fix it and all that. So that's nice. And they also did another thing with this new update, which is great for those who play it on the Apple Mac, because this is back when they actually used to make computer games that were hybrids, I guess you can call it. Some of them actually did say that on it, where it was Windows and Mac all in one disk. Which I never understood why they stopped doing that, by the way. I guess they became too complicated or too big in size for that. Just throwing that in there. But anyway, another thing that this patch does, which is fantastic for those who play it on Mac, is that they have included within this update a new installer for OS X. Yeah, so for those people who run it on Apple, it definitely should be a lot better as well. And one other thing they have done with it is also improve the cheat detection and hack prevention capabilities, which again, I can personally tell you, because I remember when I played online multiplayer on BattleNet, that was a pretty bad problem. It really is. Well, with any game that's online multiplayer, especially very popular ones like Diablo 2, you're going to have things like that happen, but it ruins the fun for everyone else, especially team-oriented games like this, and, you know, that's another good thing. But it's the modern operating system, or modern systems in general, compatibility improvements that are definitely the best thing about this update, which is great. Because sometimes modders and fans of the game, they kind of do this kind of thing on their own, with games, even popular ones sometimes don't get this kind of stuff, and it fixes problems, some obvious things that should have been fixed from the beginning or patched by the companies themselves. But it's nice to see that they're doing it themselves, Blizzard, the ones who made it. So, you know, good on them. I have no complaints with this at all. It's fantastic. I would like to say that it would be nice if they did this with the first Diablo as well, which again, I still have. That one's got similar problems when it comes to running it on modern operating systems. In fact, probably more, I'd say. As well as its expansion, which most people forget, Hellfire. Anyway, so yeah, that's nice. Another thing, though, to remember with this is it kind of does give you a little bit of hope or possibility that they would also be doing this with some of their other older games. And kind of what goes along with this, as the article points out, and I agree, is that Blizzard, a while back, was... This kind of foreshadowed it. In November, they said that they were hiring for someone for the... this is the name of the position, and... It kind of gives it away when you hear it. Senior Software Engineer, Classic Games. Yes, that's referring to all things, you know, the old stuff, of Diablo 2, Diablo, Warcraft 3, Frozen Throne, the original StarCraft. So it's very likely that they could even do the same thing for those games. I can say right now, if anything, they probably would do it the original StarCraft, because just like Diablo 2, there's still a ton of people that like and play the original StarCraft. I mean, I don't have it anymore, but I really like the original StarCraft a lot. Still never played 2, though. Kind of strange, isn't it? And Warcraft 3 Frozen Throne, which was still a very popular game now because of mods mostly, but that was also the last time that Warcraft was a normal strategy game, not a MMO. I keep hoping for them to go back to that, but that's a whole other topic. Just want to throw that in there. But yeah, it's definitely fantastic that they have done this, and with this new position that they were hiring for, it does kind of give hope that maybe they'll do this as well for their older games. And I just want to throw this one last thing in here before I move on to the next story. This is what I wish more of these game companies would be doing. I mean, again, it kind of goes back to Blizzard's always been about this. They've always kind of understood about this and cared more about their older games and those who play them, which, again, I give them full credit for that. It's fantastic. I wish more did this. But it would be nice to see more game companies taking notice of this kind of thing, that they're doing this. Maybe is to kind of give them a little push to start doing the same. You know, kind of looking at UEA, because I still have a lot of the old Need for Speed games on the computer, the good ones, and I can't run them at all. They won't install or they won't play. You know, it'd be kind of nice if he did something similar, so, you know, you can actually use them again. Just saying. It would be cool. And some other companies do as well, but definitely good. Diablo 2 is getting this without a doubt. I was kind of surprised to see that it did get it. It was a surprise update, but I'm not surprised, like I said, because Blizzard's been good with this kind of thing, so... It's nice to see that they have done this again. Alright, next up, we have something that is related to VR, but not what you'd think. And it's one of those rare times where you see one company saying something good about its competitor and making it out that they're better in some ways than they are. It's not something you usually see, yes, but Sony has changed in some ways over the years. But yeah, anyway, the deal with this is a Sony executive has admitted that the PlayStation VR might not be on the same level as the Oculus Rift in certain aspects, which, you know, that's a fair assessment. It's not going to be superior in every single way. So at least he's got the right idea about this, reasonable expectations, which, you know what, if anything, I really have to respect that this guy's honesty. I really do, because like I said, you don't see this enough, I think. You really, really don't. So, I mean, that's one of the reasons, for example, why I like Phil Spencer. If anything, the guy is upfront and he's honest. He doesn't do the usual kind of thing like most of them do. That's why I like him as well. Anyway, so let's get into this here. But Sony Computer Entertainment Vice President, and as I always mention, I'm bad with names, but I'm going to try. Masayasu Ito. I think I was close with that. I know I got the Ito right. I'll just refer to him as Mr. Ito from now on. Has said that the Rift has the edge over the PlayStation VR in terms of technical quality. And his reasons for this, I gotta say, can't really fault him for it. He's on the money with this, I think. Anyway, the PlayStation VR does have over the others, like the Oculus Rift and all that, is that those have high prices. We've all heard about what the price of the Oculus Rift is and the different bundle versions. It doesn't matter, even the cheapest one has a lot of money. But even worse than the price of these things is the minimum system requirements required you have just to use them on your given computer, your rig, whatever. Pretty hefty. I talked about this last week when I was talking about the Apple thing where they said that it's not likely to happen anytime soon, and I still stand by what I said in that, as well as agree with what the reasons they had for that. It makes sense. That was the Oculus Rift specifically, but this is also referring to other ones like the HTC Vive and all that, because there's a lot of those. Those are like the main ones. But the price is a huge barrier to entry, as well as the system requirements. While you might be able to afford it, doesn't mean you have a computer that can already, you know, run it. And even then, while you might have had enough money to buy the VR itself, doesn't mean you have even more on top of it to upgrade the current computer you have, or you want to. That's the other thing here, and that's kind of what he's referring to with this. And before I get into it, because I'm kind of going to double repeat myself, unfortunately, because I'm going to read his quotes, which he pretty much says exactly what I'm saying right now. But this is stuff I personally have already brought up many times myself in various videos, as well as when I started this show. And I really do see it as a huge problem, is the cost, the barrier to entry is cost, as well as system requirements, at least when you're talking about these ones that only are for computer. Way back, I can't remember what the name of the video is, so I can't refer to it. I've done many videos. I think it was part of maybe it was a question thing, and it was my own answers to my own question. I can't remember, sorry. But I remember what I said, and I still stand by that as well. Or maybe it was a VR to someone else. Anyway, one of the things I said at one point in that one particular video, and I've mentioned it since then, worded slightly differently, is that I really do think, when it comes to these VR things, at least for now, until things change and improve and get better as they do, you know, that's the way technology goes, the manufacturing process gets refined, cost production goes down. It's like with anything. You know, it's like SSDs. They're much cheaper now than when they first came out. Use that as an example. SD cards as well. Anyway, I really do think consoles, not just the PlayStation 4, but I guarantee the other ones are going to come out with something similar. Or if they don't, there'll be some VR that'll be make themselves compatible with it. The point is, I really do think consoles, this is one of those areas where it will do better and help more than computers will, because consoles, they all have the same hardware. So that one barrier is gone. As points out in this article, the what was it, 36 million of PlayStation 4s out there? They all are literally right now PlayStation VR compatible. It's because they all use the same VR, so that requirement's gone. Then all you have is, do you want it, do you not? And okay, fine, whatever. Do you have enough money? Do you want to spend it on it? And there aren't any games you want to use for it. That's it. All that's left is the price. Which, according to what they're kind of rumored to say here, it doesn't mention it here, but I'll just throw this in here because I brought it up with the other ones. The PlayStation VR is estimated, you can say rumored, whatever, it's going to be somewhere around anywhere from the range of $200 to $400. I'm not saying that's bad, I'm not going to say it's good, I'm saying that's reasonable, that makes sense, that is what you would expect it to be. Yes, if it is on the high end of $400, that's about what a PlayStation 4 costs before tax. So, yeah, you're going to be paying the same amount as the system, so there's a whole lot of arguments you can bring there, and I've done it myself, which I'm not going to do that here. I just want to preface what I'm about to talk about with this when I get to his quotes. That's basically what this is about, and what he's referring to, but what he's saying when he says that the PlayStation VR might not be on the same level as the Oculus Rift, because that's the specific one being used in the example here. And as he says, that's meant for high-end hardware. We're talking about consoles. Which, like it or not, and I've mentioned this before because it's the truth, and many, many others have besides me, consoles are technically out of date as soon as they come out. You can't upgrade them. that's one of the things you deal with when you deal with a console. It may be more convenient in many ways, but their hardware does not keep up with the rest of things, which you can upgrade. I can yank out the RAM I have in my computer now, put faster, better, and more in there. Can't do that with a console. Same thing with the processor. You can put a better one in there, a new generation of an Intel or an AMD. Can't do that with a console. But, you know, when it comes to this kind of thing, and this goes back to my point I said, and I know I'm going on about this a little longer than I should, but I really want to drive this home, because I really do believe in this. Consoles, this is one of those things where consoles really can help make the market penetrate with this kind of stuff, I guess is the best way to put it. It can help VR get more proliferation, basically. It'll help get it in the hands of more people, because that one huge barrier, the hardware thing, will be gone. And let's not forget, while most people might have a decently powerful computer, they probably didn't build it themselves, don't want to, or they already bought it that way. I know not everyone's like that, I'm not saying they are. You know, I had mine built for me, for example, but I knew what I wanted. I could have put it together myself, but I didn't want to do that. Even then, a lot of people don't have enough power for that, and that's a huge problem. Cost is another one. Whether or not you like the VR stuff, you might not be willing to or able to pay that amount of money. That's kind of another thing. So maybe that still might be a problem when it comes to this. But, you know, overall, at least with the PlayStation VR, because that's what I'm talking about here, I really do think, and I mentioned specifically the PlayStation VR back then, when it was still got the Project Morpheus name, I think that's how far back it was. Still the point stands. I really do think that this will be pretty much one of the first things in terms of gaming VR that the biggest majority of people will be able to get and get their hands on it and experience VR through the PlayStation VR. I really do think it, because a lot of people have PlayStation 4. like I said, somewhere around 36 million right now. So, you know, they'll have a higher chance of getting to use it than those who only have a computer or only will be able to use a VR thing for the computer. So that's the thing to keep in mind with this. All right, now all that's out of the way, I really wanted to talk about that before I got into this. So now let's get into what Mr. Ito actually said himself in his own words. So a lot of this is going to sound exactly like I already told you, but I still want to go over it anyway, because that's the point here. Anyway, now going on with his quotes, this is what Mr. Ito said. If you want to just talk about the high-end quality, yes, I would admit Oculus may have better VR. This was during an interview with Polygon. He then went on and said, however, it requires a very expensive and very fast PC. See what I mean? I know it was 10 minutes ago. I mentioned it now probably, but that's what he was getting at. He's absolutely right. He really is. I used this example last week. I'll just bring it up one more time. My computer, as it stands, its current hardware, I can use an Oculus Rift. Just barely make it. But you kind of want a little bit above that, because, you know, it requires a lot of power to run that kind of stuff on top of the game. So, you know, you're not talking about, you know, 1920 by 1080, 1080p resolution, 60 plus frames a second. You ain't going to get that stable. You ain't going to maybe even get there with it. You got to be careful, that kind of thing, because it is very demanding. It's like running the game twice. It really is. So, yeah. He's right. Oculus Rift thing is basically for high-end hardware, PC, very expensive, very fast. Even when you know what you're doing, you get the right parts and you get them on sale or whatever it is, you're still going to have quite expensive hardware. You're going to need a really good video card. You're going to need a really decent processor. If I remember right, the Oculus Rift actually minimum was an i7. That's the Intel one. Obviously, there's the equivalent for AMD. But you get what I mean? You really do need some hefty hardware to be able to run this correctly, or just be able to run it at all. So you might think that there's a lot that could do this, because, you know, you hear about all the time people have very beastly computers and all that kind of stuff. Not nearly the large number that you'd think, at least in terms of for meeting the system requirements of something like this. You might be able to run things like Star Citizen. Doesn't mean necessarily you can run something like this. That's my point. The reason I'm dwelling on this and trying to explain it the best I can is because I understand that, especially I know a lot of you guys who watch me and listen to this, I know not all of you are into playing games on the computer, or you don't do it yourself, or you barely have a little bit, or you just don't have much interest in it, or you don't understand as much about it. I understand that. You know, I started this way, so I understand much more about it, and that's why I definitely can understand when these guys come out and saying this kind of stuff. Like, again, last week we were saying about the Apple thing. I definitely can understand what they mean, and I can agree with it because I understand it. And it's definitely a problem VR has. And that's one of the reasons why I don't think it's ever going to get as widespread as so many are claiming it's going to be, like a some kind of second coming of video gaming. It's not going to be, because a huge number of people won't be able to have any access to it. They won't be able to use it. Those two things alone, price and hardware. You cannot ignore those. It's two big albatrosses that are going to cause a problem for many people. You might want to use VR, but you might not be able to do it because your particular computer might not be able to run it. And that's where, again, consoles can kind of help with this, especially if you have a PlayStation 4. If you already have a PlayStation 4, hey, you're already set to go. So there you go, at least in terms of the PlayStation 4, for VR. Yeah, so there you go. So I don't really have much else to add from what he just said, because I already explained all that before I got to his quote. There is one last thing I do want to say here about this, and it's another part of his quote here. Continuing on with what he was saying during his interview, Mr. Ito continued on with this. The biggest advantage for Sony is our headset works with PS4. He's about to say the other thing I referred to in the beginning of my whole long speech. It's more for everyday use, so it has to be easy to use, and it has to be affordable. This is not for the person who uses a high-end PC. It's for the mass market. Again, this guy is right on the money. That one thing right there you can use to explain this whole problem I've been trying to go on for, and do it a lot quicker and faster than me. He's absolutely right. And that goes back to one of my major concerns with this, and why I cannot agree with any of these ones who are going around proclaiming that it's going to be some kind of second coming of gaming, or it's going to, you know, spread like wildfire. No. Especially the ease of use thing. That's another thing. Let's go back to another episode I was talking about. And if you watch Drink a Beer, Play a Game, they did a great video on that, plugging them a little bit there. They did their own kind of individual podcast episode, much shorter than my 20 minutes I went on about back in this one I'm about to refer to, I did myself. But one of the big problems with the Oculus Rift is just how many USB ports you have to use, how you hook it up, how this, and that. And, you know, this is on top of the what it costs to get it, and if you meet the hardware. Say you pass those two. You got enough money, you get it, your computer can already handle it, or you're fine with, you know, paying whatever you need to and what you need to upgrade it. Okay, fine. Let's say we get past that. It's kind of a pain in the ass to hook up. It's not that simple, even for, you know, most of us that can know how to do this kind of stuff. It is pretty complicated. I was reading about it, looking at it myself, and I was sitting there looking, I was like, even I can't figure this out looking at it. If I had the actual thing, maybe I could, but I'm not ashamed to admit, it is pretty confusing. It's not very user-friendly for the most part. I'm not saying I can't figure it out, and I'm saying no one else can. It's just, in the end, most people that want to use VR, or most of the people that want to use it for games and have fun, other people brought this up too, by the way. It's the whole thing. It goes back to, at least on console, or just playing games in general, most people don't want to go for this kind of rigmarole. They just want to have a controller in their hand, have a nice, fun time after, you know, being at work however many hours, or just, you know, if you don't do that. They just want to have fun playing a game. They don't want to go for all this kind of crap. And that's kind of what he's referring to there, is the easy use. I didn't even mention that in my whole long thing, but that's another important part to this that you can't ignore. It really is a factor in this. It definitely is an important factor. And whatever ones are going to be easier to use, that's definitely going to be a thing that most people are going to consider. It really is. I mean, it is for me when I do things. It is for when I'm looking at a new computer mouse. So, bottom line is what I already said. I think consoles, at least in the start, are going to be the ones that are going to get this the biggest push, and it'll be the way most people are going to have access and be able to use VR. And it's probably even afford it, because it'll be less, relatively, than what the Oculus Rift and all that. But as he said, it's true. The PlayStation VR, at least, because that's the one we're talking about here, is not meant for someone who uses a high-end PC. For those who do, you're obviously going to get a lot more use out of and benefit from the Oculus Rift, games or otherwise. So he's not saying that it's going to be the be-all handle. And pretty much acknowledges, yes, the Oculus Rift still will have the upper end for this, and that's what this whole thing is about. And he actually concedes that, yes, the PlayStation VR will not be as good in the technical realm in certain areas like the Oculus Rift. And yeah, definitely true. And that's why I wanted to talk about this. So yeah, there is one last thing I want to talk about, even though this is going a long time, and I thought this was kind of interesting too, and they included it in the article, and you'll see it yourself too, you get a link. But I do want to mention this, and it's another important thing I think with this, and it really, really is reminiscent of what Nintendo still says, because they put it in the manuals and all that about the 3DS and the 3D effect, and that Sony has actually come out and said that children under 12 should not use the PlayStation VR. All I have to say about this is, yet again, I agree. I can see why they say that. It's just like with Nintendo and the 3D effect on the 3DS. You remember, right? That's why they came out with the 2DS. it was meant for children, and it doesn't even have the 3D ability. Yeah, I can see that. It's not that kids that young can't see the effect or anything like that, or including the VR thing. It's not really good for them. It really isn't. And the eyes and all that. I'm not going to get into that whole kind of thing because I'm not good at talking about that. But I'm pretty sure you've heard all this stuff already, and it's off topic anyway. I just wanted to throw that last thing in there. They already have said that children under 12 should not use the PlayStation VR. Yes, I definitely can understand that. It probably might end up breaking it too, so it's going to be expensive replacement. I think that's part of the other thing I'd throw in there is like, they might not understand to be careful with it that much. But it's more of a medical thing. Anyway, so yes, and the PlayStation VR is supposedly officially planned to release in the first half of 2016 sometime, although, and I take this very lightly, a GameStop exec recently has said that the release may be pushed back to fall. I just want to say that does sound very believable to me, because if you think about it, VR is a very hot thing, and let's face it, the gaming world, the gaming industry makes most of its money towards the end of the year near the holidays, and fall is right before then, and that's when a lot of people start buying stuff, for people for Christmas presents and all that kind of stuff. So definitely could see a lot of people getting the PlayStation VR for people, as a present. So yeah, I can definitely go along with that. Anyway, so I know I've gone on about this for a very long time, but that's kind of one of those topics. I had to get this out of here and talk about this anytime it comes up. So I promise next time when it comes up to talking about something VR, I won't go on about it as long. But this is one of those kind of things I really feel like I need to say what I gotta say about it, It's called the Gaming Ramble for a reason, guys. You know that by now. And many of you don't mind when I go on a long time, so hey, there's that too, Anyway, let's move on to the next topic now. All right, now let's talk about a game that's having a little bit of a rough time in development, but I think that it's now in good hands. I really liked the first Dead Island myself. Many others did too. Had quite a few bugs and glitches, not unlike a Bethesda game, really. Techland made that first one. I'm actually looking at the case right now. I have it off to the side here for the computer. Anyway, let's talk about Dead Island 2 a little bit, which now has a new developer who you probably know the name of. I know I do. I know him mostly for the stuff they've done with Sega. Sumo Digital, yes, and I gotta say, I kind of have a lot more confidence in this now that they're developing it because I know they got the talent. They have done quite a lot of good stuff, and again, at least from the Sega stuff that they have developed, I can easily say they got the chops to pull this off well. So, yes, anyway, that's kind of why I wanted to talk about this. So, yeah, anyway, this was confirmed when Deep Silver, who was the publisher of the series, told MCV that the new developer is Sumo Digital. This was from the previous one, which was Jaeger Productions. We'll get into the second why would thing change, but first I'm going to give you a little quick rundown of a few of the games that Sumo Digital has done so you can kind of get why I'm saying that, I'm glad that they're taking this over because they do have the talent. Just to give you a few random examples, not all Sega ones. But definitely all these you know of. Disney Infinity, Little Big Planet 3, Outrun 2, Outrun 2 SP, Outrun 2006, Coast to Coast, Toco Race Driver 2, Sonic and Sega All-Stars Racing Transformed, as well as Split Second. There's quite a many more, but those are some of the top ones I figured I'd give you some examples of. Yeah, very good games. I mean, Outrun 2006, Coast to Coast, and Toco Race Driver 2, easily some of the top ones right there. Very great racing games. Anyway, so Sumo Digital, they got the talent. They really do. Fantastic. In fact, I've always thought that if Sega ever, got off their chair to make like another Sega Rally or another Outrun game or pretty much anything like that, they should probably go to Sumo Digital because from the past they've done good work. Just saying. So I got faith in them taking over for Dead Island 2, which I gotta say, I'm pretty familiar with Sumo Digital for a long while now. Have to say, Jaeger Productions, I've heard of before this, only about once or twice. Could not tell you off of memory things they have done. So, I'm just saying, it's one of those kind of things. It's like, Rareware, yeah, we all know them, we've heard of them. Jaeger Productions, something like this. High Voltage Software, you might have heard of them, but you can't really place them that well. It's one of those kind of things. It's not like they've made any kind of significant mark that you can really remember in your head. Not like Psygnosis, something that's gone, but you still remember. Anyway, enough about that. So let's talk about the original developer and all that, and kind of the troubled development this has had. A little bit of the troubled development, not like some games, like Duke Nukem Forever. No, nothing on like that level, thankfully. The original developer for Dead Island 2, as I said, was going to be Jaeger Productions from 2015. Deep Silver, though, parted ways with them last July, and now, as I mentioned, Sumo Digital has replaced them. The reason, apparently, according to Jaeger Productions CEO Timo Juhlmann, I really had no idea how to pronounce this one, sorry, I tried, said, and quote, and, well, I'll get to that, what I want to say in a second, but this is what he said: a difference in vision for the project. Yeah, I've heard this before. That's like the most generic PR thing to say ever. Basically, what you really want to say, but you can't get away with saying it, is we didn't agree most of the time, and it just related to arguments, and this wasn't working out, so we had to go separate ways. That's exactly what it is. This is not the first time I have ever heard of this before. I could think of it. I can't remember the name of it right now, but there was a game that had even worse trouble development that was like went through so many companies. It was not on like Duke Nukem Forever in some ways, and that pretty much that exact same line came up a couple times, and I, after the third time, I was like, just give up now. It's not going to work. The final game did come out, but it wasn't that great. I'm just saying, I remember that much about it. It was a while ago. Anyway, off topic again. Sorry. This is kind of a theme for tonight. Anyway, but yeah, so it was probably a good idea for the game's sake that they kind of split ways if it wasn't working out. Although, that's not the end of it. There's more to this. The actual quote that he said in full was, Jaeger and Deep Silver's respective visions of the project fell out of alignment, which led to the decision that has been made. That I like much better. That's more of a complete thought, anyway. That's how he worded it. And I don't really have a problem with that. Again, it sounds better than the other one, but eh. Basically, it was there was arguments and wasn't going well. So, for the benefit of the project, the game, yeah, we had to go our separate ways. That's basically what happened here. Again, this is not the first time this kind of thing happened. Unfortunately, there's other games that just should have happened with, like Project Hammer, if you know the story about that one. Oh boy, that's a rough one. It's interesting, though. Anyway, so yes, but there's a little bit more to this, and this is the kind of not-so-good part. Anyway, just to add a little bit more to this, apparently later that same month, Jaeger filed for insolvency, which if you all know what that means, it means not being able to pay money owed to a person, or in this case, company, on time. Yeah, not good. This is how companies like that don't stay in business. Which, and this is the other thing, which I'm not so sure what to think about this, by the way, which claimed that was in direct result of the termination by Deep Silver. To be a little fair, maybe this wasn't entirely because of Deep Silver. I gotta say, again, I've heard of this kind of thing. This could have been also compounded from other things previous to this. You know, they weren't doing so well from other things in the past, and this just, it was the final thing that kind of really made that the only option they had to do. It's possible. I don't know. I'm just speculating, so think of it no more than that. Anyway, so yeah, it's possible, but maybe there's a little bit more from previous stuff that added to this. Just saying. Also, Deep Silver has delayed the game when it was it wasn't even at E3 of 2015, and they delayed the game to this year, 2016. So it's going to come out sometime this year. When exactly, that's not really been relayed yet. So I'm willing to guess probably no time soon. It's probably going to be mid-year or near the end of the year. Again, most games, they do kind of come out around that time because of the holidays and such and summer and yada, yada, yada. The winter is kind of the doldrums, as some say, for video games. Not a whole lot of big releases most of the time, except for things like Far Cry Primal and all that, which is actually at the top of the charts in the United States, by the way. You know, things like that. So if I had to guess, I'm willing to bet that Dead Island 2 here would probably come out probably like June afterward, somewhere around that time. Again, I'm just guessing. Seems probably likely, though. So yeah, the real question here, and this is kind of one of the reasons I wanted to talk about this, is will this slightly bump in the road kind of thing that's happened come up when the game finally releases? Will it be obvious? Changing hands of developers. I don't really think it will, because again, at least from my own personal experience of playing stuff that they have done, I believe that Sumo Digital has the talent. They can pull this off and make it work well, if not be less buggy than Techland when they did it in the first one. So I'd like to think that's the way it's going to go, and because of this changing of hands here in developers won't have any kind of detrimental effect on the game, at least nothing significant, I'd like it not to, because again, I am looking forward to this myself, but even if I don't if I wasn't, I'd still wouldn't want it to, turn out crap because a lot of other people want it, you know. So, it is a kind of a question there. Could have a little bit of an impact on that. Well, who knows? We'll say this could have been the best thing for the game. It's one of those kind of things. You never know. This could have been a blessing in disguise. It's possible. But yes, Dead Island 2 had a little bit of a kind of a shaky thing there. Switched hands developers, so now is that being developed by Sumo Digital. So good on them. Like seeing that they're getting extra work as well. So there you go. All right, I have a short one here, or at least it should be, but I do want to kind of reiterate something I've talked about in the past, just because it's been a while. Although it's nothing that none of you haven't heard already, I'm pretty sure, either by me or someone else. But anyway, this is very strong possibility that Gears of War 4 might be coming to the PC. And just to jump ahead a little bit to the point I want to reiterate, as I said, this is nothing we haven't heard before. Think about it, we've already had Xbox One, so-called, with my fingers, even though you can't see it, exclusives coming to PC. Just to bring it up again, Rise Son of Rome and Dead Rising 3. Dead Rising 3 was a sloppy port, but it still counts. So, yes, those are just two examples there. And let's not forget, another thing I want to throw in here really quick is the very recent announcement, which I actually talked about myself. The Forza series will be coming to the computer now. First, they're going to have a kind of a gimped, stripped-down, free-to-play version of 6 called Apex, but then after that they're going to have a full-on Forza. Point is, these things that were supposedly Xbox One exclusives doesn't seem like it so much anymore. And Gears of War 4 has a very high chance of that not happening either. It's probably going to be on both. So, again, it'll still be on the Xbox One, of course, obviously, but it'll also be on the PC, which is a good idea. And I'll get to why after I say what I need to talk about with this. Anyway, the reason for this is in an interview with Game Informer, development chief of Gears of War, Rod Ferguson. It's nice to see a name I can actually pronounce for a change. Just saying. Was I'm pretty sure you guys appreciate it too. Instead of me trying to bumble over trying to say their names. I feel bad when I can't do that, by the way. Rod Ferguson was asked if it would be coming to PC, which his reply was simply, possibly. Yeah, that's pretty much the best thing he could have said. And as I already said, not to repeat myself, we've already had this happen with just using those two again, Rise Son of Rome and Dead Rising 3. So yeah, and then the Forza announcement, so this is nothing new anymore. So yeah, before I get into the last thing to talk about this, because there really isn't much to say, it was he confirmed that on the I'll do it now actually. He confirmed that the of course only right now it's concrete. It's going to be on the Xbox One, which it's no surprise. If anything, it will be on the Xbox One. It's going to run at 1920 by 1080, or if you like to prefer to call it this way, 1080p. And unfortunately, this is the kind of, at least to me anyway, kicking the balls. It's only going to run at 30 frames a second in single player, but multiplayer, of course, will run at 60. I gotta say, I don't see any reason you can't make it both run in 60. Just saying. Anyway, obviously the computer version will, if it does come out, which I really do think it will, spoiler alert, jump to my end conclusion, it will run at 60, whether they do it or modders and or people are going to find INI fixes to do it. It happens all the time. Very rarely with games can you not do that. The only example I can think of right now to give you is Viking Battle for Asgard, which is permanently locked at 30 and they've never found a way to get out of it. Anyway, so going to the other thing I want to talk about here, because that's pretty much all I had to talk about from the article itself. There wasn't that much to go with. As I already said, we've seen now, at least with the Xbox One, that exclusives for supposedly exclusives have come to the computer. Those two examples, which I'm not going to mention again, I've already done it one too many times. The main point I want to make here is, and some people probably won't like to hear this because, and I don't completely disagree, yes, exclusives do sell consoles and they do need, they can't lose them all. But you got to remember, Microsoft supposedly claims that they want to do better by people who play games on the computer, people like me, than they have in the past, which is true. I can tell you personally, they have done absolutely miserable job to downright absolutely negative job in case of games for Windows Live and other joke things like making Halo 2 for the computer, but you have to only have Vista, otherwise you can't run it. Yeah, that's not the way to do things. They said they want to do better and do right by people who play games on the computer. I'm okay with that. I think they should, because remember, Windows is the dominant operating system for computers, as well as the dominant one for playing games, for good reason. I kind of referred to that last week again when I was talking about the Oculus thing. Anyway, like it or not, exclusivity, true exclusivity, is a dying thing. It's not like it used to be, doesn't serve the same purpose like it used to be, and it's not, to be honest with you, and you might not like this either, is the truth, and again, I am not the only one who said this. It's a dying thing, a very slow dying thing, it has been for a while, and it kind of doesn't it's not as needed anymore like it used to be. I mean, hell, in some ways it actually is. This is why it's hard to explain. In many ways it is, in many ways it's not. In many ways it is because, let's face it, the Xbox One, the PlayStation 4, those two, very much alike. Barely any different. You kind of need exclusives to differentiate them. At the same time, exclusives hurt people more than they help them. Because, let's face it, this day and age, forcing someone to have a certain system or platform to play a certain game when there's no real rhyme or reason for it doesn't really make sense, especially. Specifically, keep this in mind, specifically with this example, when it comes to the Xbox One in this case, and Xbox 360, even though it's older, and Windows computers. There's no reason you couldn't have them on both. Yes, it's not truly an Xbox One exclusive or Xbox 360 exclusive if it's on the computer, because they did that with the Xbox 360, by the way. Like near its launch, there was a game called Shadowrun. Not the same as the old game, by the way, but it was called Shadowrun. That was actually a cross-platform game, even for multiplayer at the time when it came out in 2007. It was on the Xbox 360 and the PC. Still technically an exclusive, but it was still only across Microsoft. See? But my point here is, when the case with the Gears of War 4 or Rise Son of Rome or even Dead Rising 3. You're really not losing an exclusive just because it's also on the computer. It's still only Microsoft. Let's not forget that. It's not on the PlayStation 4. It's not on Nintendo's stuff. It still technically is an exclusive if you want to really go at it like that. Is it only on the Xbox One? No. But you can't get on the PlayStation 4, so you're still not losing anything there. That's the kind of thing I see when this argument comes up, and that's why I really try to stay out of it because I don't like trying to argue about it because it goes very circular most of the time. Because the part when it comes in with the computer thing, most don't grasp it, especially if they don't play games with the computer, and it's hard for me to explain, even though I do. You're not really losing an exclusive if it's still only within Microsoft's own realm. Gears of War 4 being on the computer, you're not really losing anything on the Xbox One. It still is only on, when it comes to consoles, the Xbox One. So you're talking about competition with the PlayStation 4 and hell for the Wii U in there, and then the upcoming NX. You're still only going to have it on the Xbox One if you want it on that. If you don't play games on the computer, guess what? It's still technically a console exclusive when you think about it that way. Just because it'll be on the computer and people will be able to play it on there doesn't mean you're losing anything on the Xbox One. If you don't like playing games on the computer, you'll still have it on the Xbox One. Let's not forget, and this is another example, and I want to make this clear too, and the article makes it clear too. Let's not forget, very recently they came out with Gears of War Ultimate Edition on both. Both. The Xbox One and the PC. Still technically a Microsoft exclusive. Hell, they're using the Xbox brand on the computer now. That's kind of what they've been wanting to do for a long time. Others have pointed this out, and I kind of feel the need to as well. Xbox now is more or less of a console brand, it's more of an entertainment brand, because that's the way they think of it as. They want to be across everything. That's actually why it's in Windows 10. They want it to be their kind of overall entertainment platform. So, without going in much more into that, that's kind of also another reason I see is this not being much of a problem. Then putting Gears of War 4, Forza on the computer is not going to really harm anything. Some people think it will dilute or make the Xbox One or the Xbox brand in general irrelevant. I've seen that said. I'm not saying I completely disagree. I want to make that clear. I understand where some of the legitimate concern comes from with that. I understand it. There's some silly concern as well. But Gears of War 4, specifically, because that's what we're talking about here in this particular topic, coming to the computer, which is very likely it will. I don't see any reason it wouldn't, especially given they put Gears of War Ultimate Edition on the computer recently. Which, by the way, back in 2008 or 7 or 9, I think it came out a full year after the Xbox 360 version. If you think back, they already did put Gears of War on the computer. It did not sell well. Overall, it was a decent port. I've played it. It was pretty demanding at the time. You did have to have a decent video card and all that, I remember. But overall, it worked fine on the computer. It just didn't sell that well. But these days, things have changed. Many people would like to be able to play these games on the computer, especially quite a lot of these Xbox games. And hell, I'm one of them. I've been saying for years, I always wanted Forza on the computer. That's the top one for me because I love racing games. Want Forza on the computer. I got nothing against Xbox, mentioned before. I like the Xbox 360 a lot. Love the original Xbox. But I don't want to get an Xbox One just to play Forza. Me personally, I'm within this demographic that will definitely make use of it if they put it on the computer, which again they are with Forza. And you know what? I had fun with Gears of War. Really like I had fun with the first one. Really liked the second one a lot. So I'd be within that range of probably considering to get Gears of War 4. They'll probably only put it on the Microsoft Store, which they're already going to do that with the Forza game, which you shouldn't be surprised. No, they're not going to put that on Steam, even though they do with Rise and Dead Rising 3. There's a whole other subject for that, which I'm not going to get into. But I'm sure you can figure out why. But I don't see it as a problem. I really don't. I know I'm going on about this longer than I should, but I feel like I kind of need to address that because that's something that's been a lot of people are talking about lately since this came out, about Gears of War 4 has a very high chance of coming on the PC. I wouldn't also say this, if I did not play games with Pierre, if I didn't have that perspective, like I said, I started that way, and I don't still play games with Pierre. I play more older stuff than I do the latest current stuff coming out, but I still do play current games on the computer. Even if I didn't have that, I wasn't able to have that kind of perspective, I still would be saying the same thing. I still would say it's a good thing for both sides. It's good for the ones playing on the computer, but it's also good for those on the Xbox as well. Series does matter. That means they make more. Obviously, you know, people want sequels to all these things all the time. Well, guess what? If it does more, they'll give the signal to them and they will make more of them. So that one small reason alone is good for you too, you know. And again, the other thing to come back to is just because it'll be on the PC doesn't mean the Xbox One version is going to be any way, shape, or form, you know, ruined. It just is not. So, if anything, they might mess up the computer port. That's a very possible thing. That's what a lot of people I've seen already saying about Forza, and I kind of got the concerns with it, too. So, you know, that's the way it is with anything like that. But, personally, I gotta say, being able to have the perspective from both sides, don't see it as a bad thing. You know, PC port aside, how that's gonna turn out, I don't see it as a bad thing. And it has a very high chance of coming to the PC. Again, for the reasons that I gave, Rise, Son of Rome, Dead Rising 3, the Forza games, they, official word, will be coming to the computer. Now, they even said there's no reason not to. They themselves see reason to. But they even made it clear they're not going to stop putting them on the Xbox. Why would they? They'd be stupid. If I was running the show there, I would say the same thing. No, we're not going to stop putting them on the Xbox. Why? You thought Phil Spencer, he said, no, we're not going to stop putting them there. Why will we? It'd be silly. But we should also be, like, as we say we want to do, we should also be doing this for those on the computer, because we do understand that there is a kind of a gap there for our stuff. We could do something here. We can make money. It benefits us as well. That's the reason for it. That's why. So, yeah, I don't know what else to say about it. You know, I hope they don't put Games for Windows Live in it. I think that's pretty much not likely, but you never know. But outside of that, in terms of computer version of Gears of War 4, I'm kind of looking forward to it, actually. I really do think I'd get it. Gears of War 2 is still my favorite, but if 4 is a little bit like that one in some ways to me, reminds me of it, I'll have fun with it myself, and I'll get to play on the computer, and I don't have to buy an Xbox One, because why should I and I don't want to, you know? I got an Xbox One controller. Let me pretend I have an Xbox One, only I'm playing on my computer. I can do that. I'm fine with it. And in terms of the last thing I want to say here is I've seen, like, the reveal thing they did for Gears of War 4. I'm not really keeping high up on it. But I have watched a good amount of stuff for Gears of War 4. They're showing the gameplay stuff and all that kind of thing. I'm liking what I'm seeing of it. It looks interesting. It looks like just another Gears of War game, I'll be honest. But you know what? So what? I had fun with them. I had fun with them in co-op. So, you know, I think it'll be fine. If you're just curious what I think about Gears of War 4 on its own, the game itself. If I had an Xbox One, I'd probably get it. If you're curious about that too, yeah. I had fun with that series. So, I find it interesting. Anyway. So, yes, very, very likely that Gears of War 4 will be coming to the PC. No official word yet. Keep that in mind. And personally, yes, I say very likely, given all the things that have happened recently, what Microsoft themselves have said, especially the Forza thing and how we've already had two exclusives already come onto the computer. So, more would not be impossible. I wouldn't say expect Halo just yet, but... then again, that's happened before, too. First Halo was on the computer. Gearbox made it. And then you, of course, had Vista-only Halo 2, but still it counts. So, yeah. Anyway, but that's all I have to say about this one. A little longer than I should have, I admit. But whatever. That's the way it goes. On to the very last topic, and it's a very short one, but I think an important one to get out there, as I said in my intro. And despite what I said, this isn't really a shorter episode at all. If anything, it's a little bit longer than the last one. Hey, that happens. Anyway, so the last thing I have to talk about here is very short, but I think it's an important thing to put out there because quite a lot of us like import games, but we don't really have that... Well, I'm not going to say there isn't many things you can use. There is plenty of things, like Play Asia. That's a big one many use. eBay, even. But we don't really have as many or easily accessible sites or places that we already normally use that we can get this kind of stuff. But great news. There are a few strings to this. It's not perfect. But it definitely is a step in the right direction, I think. and you might have already heard of us before, but if you haven't, Amazon Japan now, yes, they will ship games internationally. There are a few rules and kind of strings with this, but overall, I think it's a step in the right direction, definitely, and I was very happy when I heard this myself. Not like I get a ton of import games, but you know what? I definitely think it's good, and it means good for me because I got a Vita, so, you know, just saying. Anyway, yes, this was kind of discovered by someone first on Twitter who goes by the name handle Hadler. I don't know who it is, I'm just saying. I'm just telling you what's going on here. And then was tested by those who you probably heard of this as well, NeoGAF Forums members. They tested it and confirmed, yes, this works. As I mentioned, there are some strings, and I want to go over those before I kind of do tell you what I think of the whole over thing. Some of the catches with this, it will not work with third-party sellers, apparently, only if it's fulfilled by Amazon itself. I can kind of understand that for quite a few reasons. I mean, taking the import stuff out of this, if you're just getting stuff domestically, if you've probably used Amazon, you've noticed this. If you get something fulfilled by Amazon themselves versus a third-party seller, you do get certain benefits from getting it from Amazon themselves, opposed to a third-party seller. Just saying, it's been that way forever, so I can kind of see that's the way it works. Maybe that might change a little bit down the road. They'll take notice of how well it's received and how many people are using it, and then they want to get on it. You know, it's one of those kind of things. Very possible. But for now, only if it's fulfilled by Amazon, so keep that in mind. But that's fine, because if you're doing this, you're probably going to get it for new games, like, say, Vita, PlayStation 4, or whatever the hell it might be, you know. Keep in mind, region locking is still a thing you have to deal with. That hasn't changed. But, you know, Amazon Japan will ship games internationally. Doesn't mean the games still won't be region locked. You know, 3DS, region locked, just saying. You still got to deal with that. But anyway, if you have a Japanese 3DS, then hey, there you go. Problem solved. Get a Japanese 3DS from them this way. There you go. Anyway, so yes, that's a problem with it. It's a flaw. There's another thing with this, Amazon Prime, and this is another thing that really should not be a surprise. Amazon Prime does not work overseas either. Again, that might change. I see that less likely than the third-party sellers. But Amazon Japan already does express shipping overseas, so honestly, that kind of alleviates that problem. I mean, yes, if you have Amazon Prime, you would like to use that, but since Amazon Japan already uses express shipping, I think that's a little bit of a kind of a cushion, and you can kind of, you know, wave that off a little bit as a little bit of a less of a string than the other one. The first thing definitely is kind of a little bit of disappointment, but that could change. I really think it probably will at some point. So there's that. There's a few wrinkles in it, but you know what? It really is a step in the right direction. Again, there's things like PlayAsia and all that, but I know a lot of people would love to be able to use just like something they already use regularly as it is, like Amazon. A lot of people use Amazon more than PlayAsia. So if they can use that kind of thing to get import games, they'd probably jump up and down at the chance of that, you know? And if I did it a lot more than I do, which I do it very rarely, I'll be completely honest, only if for certain reasons, certain ones. But you know what? I definitely would be using Amazon now, I think. You know, like I said, I got a Vita. I get Japanese versions of games for that. It'll be a lot easier for me. It's not that nothing's wrong with PlayAsia or some of those other sites. You know, they're very good sites. You hear about people talking about it all the time. They recommend them for good reason. I've done it. But, you know, now that Amazon Japan is doing international shipping, this is going to help a lot of people out. It's going to make a lot of people happy, and I approve. It's a good thing. I see no problems with this at all. And I really do think the third-party seller thing probably will change once they notice this the way this kind of thing works. They'll notice stuff like this, and then they'll try to get on board with it. Like, hey, they're doing this. I can get on some of this. I can make even more money or whatever. So, yeah, that could change. I don't see any real problem with that. It might cost them a little bit more, but they'll make more money. So, there was that, you know. But yeah, it's a real short, quick thing, but I wanted to get it out there if you don't already know about it. I think it's definitely a great thing for everyone, you know. And if you want to get, and here's another thing, and this is something I thought about just now. If you want to get into importing games, this might make it even easier and better for you. Because you're probably already familiar with Amazon. You don't want to, you know, try and figure out all these other sites, PlayAsia, even though it's a very popular and well-known one. Maybe this might help you get your foot in the door and start importing. You know, if you're not so sure about it and you're just starting off with it, then maybe if you're trying to find certain other stuff, like older stuff or whatever, more special, specific things, then you might have to go to some of the other sites. But still, I think this is definitely a step in the right direction in general in terms of importing games, and especially, like Amazon, yet another benefit for it, Amazon Japan anyway. So yes, there you go. You like importing games? You have a new option now. Amazon Japan will ship games internationally. So whether you're in the United States, you're in Canada, or you're in England or Germany, take a look at Amazon Japan if you like importing games. You might be very happy and get some good deals as well. Don't forget about that. Anyway, so that is it for this episode. As always, thank you for listening, and I will see you later.